the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
Today we celebrate Good Shepherd Sunday, and also in a special way on this Sunday we pray for vocations, especially to the priesthood. So we pray that the Holy Spirit may inspire the hearts of many young men to respond to the call to work in the vineyard of Christ as shepherds after his name and in his person. First, we acknowledge our sinfulness, ask the Father for mercy as we prepare ourselves to offer the sacred mysteries. I confess to thee, Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and the saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. And may the Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Glory of God the Father.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, lead us to a share in the joys of heaven, so that the humble flock may reach where the brave shepherd has gone before, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said, "Leaders of the people and elders, if we are being examined today about a good deed done to a cripple, namely by what means he was saved, then all of you and all the people of Israel should know that it was in the name of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. In his name, this man stands before you healed. He is the stone rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. There is no salvation through anyone else, nor is there any other name under heaven given to the human race by which we are to be saved." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone.
The stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. The stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone. I will give thanks to you, for you have answered me and have been my Savior. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done. It is wonderful in our eyes. The stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. I will give thanks to you, for you have answered me and have been my Savior. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his kindness endures forever. The stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone. A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, see what love the Father has bestowed on us, that we may be called the children of God. Yet so we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. We do know that when it is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. From the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. A good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. A hired man who is not a shepherd and whose sheep are not his own sees a wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away, and the wolf catches and scatters them. This is because he works for pay and has no concern for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know mine, and mine know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I will lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. These also I must lead, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock, one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own. I have power to lay it down and a power to take it up again. This commandment I have received from my Father. The Gospel of the Lord. This Sunday, we celebrate Good Shepherd Sunday. Note, Jesus is saying, I am the Good Shepherd. He doesn't simply say, I am the Shepherd. I am the Good Shepherd. So that word is key, good. The image of shepherd and people, or master, the shepherd and sheep, is not new. Jesus is not introducing a new image. This image is very much alive in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament. Many of us are very familiar with Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. So God always reveals himself to his people as a shepherd, using the image of a shepherd, and the people are his sheep. And he leads them to greener or rich pastures so that they are very well taken care of. That image of shepherd, again, we see it very often in the Old Testament, like Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 1 through 6, Jeremiah talks about the image of a shepherd. But the most important text here in the Old Covenant is Ezekiel chapter 34. So I want you, when you go home, read Ezekiel chapter 34. In that chapter of Ezekiel, God basically complains about the shepherds he had entrusted his flock with. So he says that these shepherds took care of themselves. Instead of taking care of the sheep, they took advantage of the sheep. And so I myself will come and take care of my sheep. I will feed them. I will protect them. I will lead and guide them. I myself, the Lord God says, Yahweh says, Yahweh himself, God himself will take care of the flock to feed, to protect, and to lead, and to guide. So that text of Ezekiel chapter 34 is fulfilled in Christ Jesus, as we hear him today calling himself that good shepherd. I am the good shepherd, not simply a shepherd, because they are bad shepherds, but I am the good shepherd. And who is good? Remember, a rich young man came to Jesus and said, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit the kingdom of God?" And Jesus responds, "Why do you call me good? Only God is good." So when Jesus Christ says, "I am the good shepherd," it is the fulfillment of Ezekiel chapter 34, that it is God himself become man, the incarnate God, that has come to take care of his people, his flock. That's why he uses the word, "I am the good," meaning God. I am the good shepherd. God himself is coming to shepherd his people. A shepherd, as we see the image of God in the Old Testament, is to feed, to protect, to lead, and to guide. I will shepherd my sheep myself, meaning I will feed them, I will guide them, I will protect them, I will lead them. So Jesus Christ today says, a good shepherd lays down his life for his friends or for his sheep, meaning that God, the good shepherd God, is going to lay down his life for his sheep. The purpose of laying down his life for the sheep is to feed them, to protect them, to lead and to guide them. That is something very significant. The way God is going to do that is by laying down his life for his sheep. So the sheep must be fed on rich pastures to remain healthy. So when the shepherd, the good shepherd, lays down his life for his sheep, what happens? "You will eat my flesh and drink my blood." That is how God, the good shepherd, feeds his flock. He feeds the flock on his very life, his divine life, my flesh and my blood. Whoever partakes of it will have life, but that life is eternal, because I am eternal, and you are basically having a share. You are partaking in my very life. That is how the good shepherd God feeds his flock. We are that flock of God, the sheep he shepherds, and indeed he feeds us on himself. He tells us the word, "I will give you my flesh to eat and my blood to drink." And indeed he actually does it through his passion and death. He gives us a share in his very life. The cross unleashes divine life, that whoever believes in him, who partakes of that body and blood in faith, indeed becomes a sharer in the very life of the good shepherd. And indeed, whoever partakes of him also becomes good. That's why we call ourselves Christians, or Christ-like, or other Christs. That is who the good shepherd is. And who wouldn't want to be under the guidance of that shepherd? who basically dies so that his flock, his bride, the church, may have life, may feed on him and have life. That is how he feeds the flock. That's how he protects his flock from demonic attacks, the wolves, okay? From demonic attacks, by giving them a very share of his life so that death may have no power over them. Sin may have no power over them. The mystery of the Eucharist is what protects us from the powers of the evil one, the power of death, because the Eucharist is life, life eternal, divine life itself. That's how he feeds us. He leads and guides because the Word became flesh. So we hear the Word of God, like today it's proclaimed and we are expounding it. That is the Word. Okay? That's how God leads and guides us, by his voice. The Word of God resounding in the church is the voice of the Master, the voice of Christ. He leads us to the rich pastures of the Eucharist by his voice, Word and Sacrament. He invites us by his Word, come to me, I am the Good Shepherd. And those who respond in obedience become partakers of the rich pastures he feeds us on, the mystery of the Eucharist. That is the Good Shepherd, Christ Jesus, who lays his down for his sheep. A hired man, when they see a wolf, death, sin, falsehood, they run away. Who are hirings? Basically bad shepherds, hired men. Remember that Jesus is the shepherd, the shepherd. But this shepherd has special servants who also will shepherd the flock in his name, in his person. Those are the apostles. Today we have them as bishops, and under the bishops, priests. So those are our shepherds. They are basically, Jesus communicates sacred power and he gives them a share in his shepherding as the head of the church, the head of the flock. So they are true shepherds after his name. Now these shepherds must shepherd in the name and person of Jesus Christ, meaning that they must speak the word of Christ, because you cannot lead the sheep by any other voice except the voice of Christ. That's why a priest, a bishop, a priest, but more so bishops, must be faithful to the voice of Christ, because they have the fullness of the priesthood, they are full shepherds in Christ Jesus, and they have the power and the authority, the obligation to lead and to guide the flock. Again, it is these shepherds acting in the person and name of Jesus that Christ Jesus gives us of himself, gives himself to us in flesh and blood in the Eucharist. You know that without a priest, we cannot have the Eucharist. We cannot confect the Eucharist. So these are true shepherds in the name of Jesus Christ. We have the duty to constantly pray for our priests. I have told you this before. We have the duty to pray for our priests, that they don't become bad shepherds, but good shepherds after Christ Jesus. Because if, as we hear in Psalm 18, this responsorial psalm today is Psalm 118. So in that psalm we hear that the stone rejected by the builders, the builders are basically the shepherds God has entrusted his flock with to shepherd in his name, in his person. But if these builders reject the shepherd, the builder himself, but they continue to build, what are they building? What is the nature of the structure you are building if that nature is not truth, is not goodness, is not love? We cannot build apart from God. Every time we try to build apart from God, the structures we build are basically evil, demonic, not the church. And so, there are in the church many good shepherds, who are faithful to the voice of Christ, and through them, the voice of Jesus continues to sound in the church, inviting people to the rich pastures Christ offers to us, word and sacrament, especially the Eucharist, which is the source of all goodness. Those good shepherds are there. They are faithful to the truth. That's how we know them. And the way you know that they are faithful to the truth is when they are faithful to the magisterium. The magisterium is the Pope and the bishops united with him. When they teach us about faith and morals, they cannot err. They cannot go wrong because they have the guarantee of the Holy Spirit to teach the truth. I don't have that charism as a priest. Bishops do. The Pope does. So when they teach officially about faith and morals, we, the flock, must listen. Because what they teach concerning faith and morals together, the Pope and the bishops united with him, Catholic bishops united with him, which we call the magisterium. Magister is teacher in Latin. So magisterium means the teaching office in the church. Jesus Christ himself instituted that teaching office when he appointed the 12 and gave them authority to teach in his name. And so the way you know a good bishop, the way you know a good, especially a good priest, because most of us here don't encounter bishops. We see them maybe once a year, or a bishop, but you see priests. The way you know a good priest is when a priest listens to the Pope and the bishops when they are teaching about faith and morals. Every time you hear a priest who disparages a bishop, but mostly who disparages the Pope, you know that that is a bad priest. And you shouldn't listen to such a priest who disparages the Pope and the bishops. Why? Because when they are teaching us about faith and morals, it is the very voice of Christ resounding among us, inviting us to the rich pastures of Jesus Christ. Every time you see a priest who invites us to Christ, pointing us to Christ, teaching the truth, as the church basically presents it to us, that is a good priest. Every time you hear a priest who basically talks about himself all the time, seeking his own glory, not pointing us to Christ, but pointing us to himself, meaning that we know about the likes and dislikes of our priest more than we know about Christ from him, that is a bad priest, seeking his own glory, not the glory of Christ. The way we know a good priest is when the priest speaks the truth in charity. Usually we hear that phrase, speak or say the truth in charity. What that means is that say the truth as it was given to you. Don't obscure, don't twist. Don't wound the truth. Present it as it is given to you. That is the meaning of charity. Every time we try to obscure under the guise of being compassionate, every time we try to twist, you know, to simplify things for the people, I am seeking my popularity, not the glory of God. And so bad shepherds always seek their own glory, and the way we know that is by their calculation when they teach. Some of us priests, when we know that maybe most people in our parish tend to be liberals, given into those, you know, human ideologies, then a priest tends to lean liberal, teaching liberal things, you know, to make people happy, to please people, so that they may put more money, I don't know, maybe in the baskets. God doesn't eat money. God doesn't need our dollars. As Jesus told people on what we call Palm Sunday, he told them that if you prevent these people from praising me, I can command stones to praise me. I don't need your false attitudes. I need you to adhere to the truth. So some priests, when they know that maybe most people in their parishes lean conservative, then they start preaching conservatism instead of the truth. That's how we know bad priests, bad shepherds. They don't hold on to the truth because they are afraid that they are going to lose popularity. They are going to lose favor with the people. Today, we hear a good shepherd in our second reading from the Acts of the Apostles, Peter. He cured a crippled man, and then the Sanhedrin convened, basically called him in and told him to stop preaching in that name. And then he said, if it is by the curing this man, that you are basically blaming me, not by whose power I did this. By the power of Christ Jesus, whom you crucified. There is nothing to obscure the truth. The Son of God, our salvation, you crucified him. You rejected the cornerstone. But indeed, he has become the cornerstone, the stone rejected by you. He was talking to priests and Pharisees. This stone rejected by you has become the cornerstone. So it's up to you now either to repent of your sinfulness and come to the living stone Christ Jesus and have life, or persist in your stubbornness and self-vain glory and be ruined. That is a good teacher. That is a good shepherd after the heart of Jesus Christ. That is called speaking the truth in charity. Oftentimes when we say, oh, must speak the truth in charity, we mean don't say the truth, obscure it, because people will be offended. That attitude drives me crazy. When a Christian, a Catholic says, well, I don't wear a cross, or I don't make the sign of the cross in a restaurant, or I don't do this because people maybe might be offended. Really? If the truth which you believe, you yourself who believes it, think it is offensive, why do you believe it? Or people will be offended by the truth? If the truth is offensive, so be it. Jesus whom you crucified, Jesus whom you rejected, you builders, you were appointed by God to be builders, but you are building on a different foundation, evil. That's what Peter was telling the Sanhedrin. The one you rejected is the cornerstone of the structure. So you decide where to build. Or people might be offended. How can a Catholic fear to witness to the truth, to Catholic truth, Christian truth? And the reason you give is people maybe might be offended. How foolish that is. If my faith, if our faith is offensive, they don't believe it. If people get offended by the truth, it is their problem. It's not the problem of the one presenting, proclaiming the truth. Jesus proclaimed the truth. Some people accepted it. Some people were offended by it because they were evil. And that's why they killed him. So if you think truth is offensive, you are evil. Because it is the evil one who is offended by the truth. So today, as we hear Christ the Chief Shepherd, who gave us, all of us, not only priests and bishops, but also all of us share in some way in the shepherding ministry of Jesus Christ. By virtue of our baptism, we became priest, prophet, and a king. A king is a shepherd. So we must shepherd one another in some way. That's where Jesus tells us, love one another. That is shepherding. So it's not only the role of a priest and bishops, those have a special role, but each one of us also, by virtue of our sharing in the shepherding ministry of Christ, we have also the role to shepherd one another. And the only way we can shepherd one another is by the truth Christ gives us, because it is that truth that gives us life. His word become incarnate in body and blood, and when we partake of it and proclaim it, we become alive in him, and we make the world around us alive in him. That is the mission we have, to be the light of the world, not the darkness of the world. You don't light a lamp and hide it under a bushel basket. My faith is private. Really? They might be offended. Christ lit you and you're under a bushel basket. So why are you a Christian? Why am I a Christian if that is my attitude? Shepherding means to go and proclaim so that we become the light of the world to dispel the darkness out there. And if we shepherd one another after the truth Christ has entrusted to us, indeed we will become light and become light-giving. Now let us profess what we believe. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit, he was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now let us offer our prayers to the Father, trusting that he hears and answers the prayer of his flock.
That the pastors and ministers guide their flocks with tender care. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That governments carefully guard the safety and quality of food and water. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That young people preparing for confirmation and graduation be strengthened for a life of loving service through the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That Christians spread the peace of Christ and the joy of Easter in every time and place. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
That the members of this assembly share God's abundant feast with those who cannot be here, especially the sick and homebound. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Father, in your mercy, receive the prayers we offer you through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that we may always find delight in these Paschal mysteries, so that the renewal constantly at work within us may be the cause of our unending joy. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. And let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. By the oblation of his body, he brought the sacrifices of old to fulfillment in the reality of the cross. And by commending himself to you for our salvation, he showed himself the priest, the altar, and the lamb of sacrifice. Therefore, overcome with Paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Earth, heaven, and earth are full.
are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Holy Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and the blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving you thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more, giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and the eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and the blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Thomas, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. And all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse, the blessed apostles, and all your saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the glorious coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer to one another the gift of his peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray in thanksgiving. Look upon your flock, kind shepherd, and be pleased to settle in eternal pastures the sheep you have redeemed by the precious blood of your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Continuing to pray for the intercession of Saint Joseph, the universal patron of the Church, we pray this prayer given to us by Pope Francis in this year of Saint Joseph. Together, hail, guardian of the Redeemer, spouse of the Blessed Virgin Mary. To you, God entrusted his only Son. In you, Mary placed her trust. With you, Christ became man. Blessed Joseph, to us too, show yourself a father and guide us in the path of life. Obtain for us grace, mercy, and courage, and defend us from every evil. Amen. The Lord be with you. And may the Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. This Mass is ended. Amen.